Good morning, friends. In today's lecture, we try to cover a part of sampling process in a marketing research. How, what are the different types of sampling methods? Then we will come to that data analysis part, starting with the data preparation and data cleaning, and then go to the data analysis. What are the different techniques of data analysis? Depend on the sample and the type of probability or non-probability sampling you have drawn the sample, and depend on the type of sample which you have drawn from the independent or period structures. And then at last we will come to the report section, how you present the reports of the results which you taken out from the data analysis. Now when we start the sampling process, we have to first clarify some of the words. There are two basic terms in sampling. It is called population or generally it is called universe. The population of a research or universe for a research depends on what are the elements or what are the respondent, what are the points which cover on your research area. Suppose I want to study a study circle, my scope of the study in Rajasthan, then, and I want to study the literacy rate, then the population will include the total population of Rajasthan, and then from this total population of Rajasthan I take out a section or a sample. So the elements which included in the population depends on, solely depends on the research type or research objective. Suppose if I want to study customer satisfaction for a mobile banking, then my population will consist only those people who has a bank account and make transaction through the mobile devices, their smartphones. Then that all people or all the customers or bank customers who make transactions through mobile devices, through mobile smartphones, will be my customers. If I want to make survey of analyzing the customer satisfaction or employee perception in a hotel industry, then in Rajasthan, then all employees included or working in a hotel industry in Rajasthan will be my population of universe. And then from that, all sample or employee, number of employees, I take out a section or sample. So these are the two words. One more word which we have to clarify is a sample unit. The sample unit, it's an, it depend on two things. What are the research objective? What are the elements or what kind of respondent that can be included in the research or the population? Suppose I want to study customer satisfaction, then the single customer is my sample unit. If I want to study employee satisfaction, then the single employee is my sampling unit. So it depends solely on the research objective. Now when we come forward to the types of sampling research, there are basically two types of the sampling: probability sampling and non-probability sampling. Probability sampling and non-probability sampling techniques. The basic difference between these two, that in a probability sampling, all elements in a population has an equal chance to be selected in a sample. So if all elements in a population has equal chance to be selected in a sample, then it is called a probability sampling, because some kind of probability is attached, some weightage of probability is attached to this each and every element in the population. As we know that a probability can differ from or in the range from 0 to 1, so that all has an equal chance. In a non-probability sampling, based on our convenience, based on our judgment or based on our ability, then I will select according to my choice at the sample from the population. So this is the basic difference. Now this basic difference will another reflect to the type of sampling techniques. When we come to the probability sampling, there are simple random sampling, popularly known as SRS, then systematic sampling, then stratified sampling, and cluster sampling. So this simple random sampling, stratified sampling, systematic sampling and cluster sampling are the most commonly example of this probability sampling. And there are certain examples for certain classification of non-probability sampling. We will discuss this in the further lecture. Now we explain this one by one. When we come to this simple random sampling, it has this word random, which means the sample from the population is selected randomly, and since it is a probability sampling, therefore all elements has an equal chance or equal opportunity or equal probability of getting selected in the sample. So the technique is simply selecting the randomly selecting the elements from the population to make the sample. So this means this is the most appropriate technique when we want to increase or when we want to enhance the validity of the result, because there is no chances of biasness. So when the research objective or when the results to be highly validated, then we use this type of sampling. The basic disadvantage you can say is about the cost and time. Required for the collection of data, as it is a random sampling, so as we don't know how what kind of elements got selected. If suppose, and as we have seen in this an example of Rajasthan population, if the population of Rajasthan is my universe of the study, then I don't know which respondent or from where the respondent has got selected. So it requires a time and considerable time and considerable cost to get data from those selected samples, those selected elements of the sample. So which means that this is the basic disadvantage of adopting simple random sampling. Largely this kind of sampling technique is used in those studies which is not constrained with this cost and time effort. Large consulting companies, government projects, long-term research, large funded research generally use this random sampling, and research which require a higher validity of the result, so that you can generalize the result to that if the sample is taken from the random SRS or simple random sampling, then we can say the results are equally valid and can be generalized to reflect the population characteristics. In the next part, when we see systematic sampling, in a systematic sampling there are two ways or two steps in which the population's element are selected to constitute a sample. First, we select the start point. Suppose all elements in a population are identified or given an ID or a number or an identification number, say 1, 2, 3 up to a serial number. Then we have to select an start point from where to start picking the sample unit. So this selection of a start point will be done by simple random sampling. That's why it is a category of probability sampling technique. So this start point has been selected by this SRS. And in the second step, we decide on the interval. Interval means the gap between the selected element and the next consecutive selected element. It means, suppose if the interval is 100, then if suppose using SRS or simple random sampling, if I select an element with serial number 59 through simple random sampling, then the next selected element will be 159 and the next selected element will be 259, and hence from this we can select required number of units in the sample. So this is called systematic sampling. Advantage: it has a characteristics of probability sampling, that's why the results can be validated easily. It is an easy approach. You have to just pick one element during SRS and then the rest element will be automatically selected using that interval part. Next part is stratified sampling. The word this stratified has been made from strata. Now the strata means when a population is classified into some subgroups. Suppose these are the population elements and we make kind of classification, make some stratas from this population. Now these stratas can be made by having some characteristics or some identification characteristics from this population. Suppose I classify based on age, I classify make a strata based on gender, I classify strata based on occupation. So these are my three stratas from this population. And when I constitute a sample from it, suppose sample will constitute 100 elements from this population, then the elements from each strata will be selected using simple random sampling. So that's why it is a category of probability sampling. So this is how this stratified sampling works. First we divide the population into identified set of stratas. Stratas are made up of elements which are homogeneous characteristics. Homogeneous means the elements within the strata are identical, have share the same characteristics among themselves. So these are homogeneous, but the stratas among themselves are heterogeneous. So that is why we select each element from the strata to make up the sample. The same approach is applied in next sampling technique, that is called cluster sampling. But there is a difference. Here the same, this is the population, we make clusters out of it. So these are the clusters you can make, see. And from this cluster, we make the sample. The difference between the stratified and the cluster sampling is that the cluster is made up of heterogeneous elements. And if suppose I want to take out a sample of 100 elements, then suppose in this example we make 3 clusters of 100 elements each. So we take three samples, three sub-samples you can say, three clusters of having heterogeneous elements of equal size of the identified sample, and from these three cluster, a cluster will be selected, a whole cluster will be selected for a sample to become a identified or to become a research sample through SRS. So that's why it is comes to the probability sampling category. So this is the difference between the stratified and clustered sampling. In stratified sampling, the stratas are having elements of homogeneous characteristics. They are exclusively heterogeneous. In this, the clusters itself are heterogeneous, and somehow they are taken from this same population, and then we make the sample. And from this three clusters, we use SRS to select only one cluster. So this is somehow can get one stage clustering, because we make the sample from a single stage or single process to become a sample from the cluster. So this is how the probability sampling are classified. Now we come to the non-probability part. The first technique of non-probability sampling is convenience sampling. The convenience sampling means from our convenience, from the convenience of the researcher, from the convenience of the cost, time, effort, respondent availability, data availability, from all this convenience point we select the respondent or the sample units from the population. When we use our judgment to select the sample, through our convenience we select the sample units, and through our judgment we select whether this respondent is a qualified respondent for my research or not, then sampling becomes judgmental sampling. For example, suppose I want to make a survey of this mobile banking, customer satisfaction towards mobile banking, and through convenience sampling I select a list of respondents which are my friend. Now from my friends list, so if I took my friends list, that is my convenience sampling, but from the friend list I check only those, I contacted only those friends which has used mobile banking or mobile asset for the banking transactions, then I use my judgment. So when the researcher uses the convenience as well as the judgment, the sampling technique becomes judgmental sampling. So some time in a research report, when we use non-probability sampling, we can write we have used convenience judgmental sampling. We used judgmental sampling. It means the convenience is inbuilt. The next part of this judgmental sampling, next part of the non-probability sampling is quota sampling. Quota sampling is made up of the word quota. It means a certain categories which has certain set of percentage of distribution. How we assume that from making a sample from this quota? Suppose one of my research based on HR, and I want to make a sample of constitution of gender, male and female in Rajasthan. Now suppose if my population, Rajasthan population, male and female distribution is suppose 50 to 40%, 50% are, sorry, suppose 55% to 45%. We assume that the males are higher than females. So there are 55% males and then 45% of females. So this data can be generated, easily generated from the last census report, statewide report. Then when we make this sample out of this population, when we take the sample of it, then my sample will also constitute of the same distribution. Means my sample will constitute of 55% male and 45% female. So that is a sample characteristic. So if I am taking 100 elements of a sample, 55% should be male and 45% should be female. So I will collect 55 males and 45 females from my 100 sample. So this is how maintain the distribution. The same distribution also, the population distribution is also maintained in the sample distribution. So that the sample will be more representative. So the sample will be more representative, you can easily validate the results. Another technique apart from this quota sampling is called snowball sampling. Now this is snowball sampling means a snowball bird has been made from the bird snowball. When the snowball, a small snowball revolves down to the mountain and then it's gathered around this ice and become large at the end. So when we start, so this is sampling, it is resembled to the snowball falling from the mountain or some snowfall. So in this the same, how you start the sampling process. So this sampling technique is generally used when we don't know about the qualified respondent or we don't know about a large set of respondent to get data for. Now suppose I am doing some medical investigation or medical investigation towards the medical people who have certain disease, and I don't know what are the different patients in my locality of the same disease. So what I only know only one person in my locality or in my friend list or in my colleagues or neighborhood. So I approach that person and then I ask that person to give some references of some other patients who are suffering from the same disease. And then I ask this 3% more for more contacts, and then how this is become last. So I don't have a predefined set of or predetermined procedure of increasing the sample. I started with one or two people which I know. Why it is called probability sampling? Because I selected this starting point with my convenience, with my knowledge, with my judgment. So that is why it's called non-probability category. And as I go down, at the end, I increase my sample size. So these are some techniques of sampling techniques. So sampling techniques are generally categorized on two parts, probability and non-probability sampling. Some other facts about the sampling are, when we go for sample, when the budget is small, when the time availability is short, population size is very large, then we adopt sampling techniques. When there is a variance in the characteristics is very small, because if the variance is very large, then you cannot take out the sample from the population. So the variance between the population elements should be small. And the cost of sampling error is low. When the cost of sampling error is high, then we cannot do the sampling. We have to do the census analysis. And the cost of non-sampling error is high. The nature of measurement is to be descriptive and non-descriptive. Then attention to the individual cases, then yes. If there is no requirement of attention to individual cases, then we can easily go for census. Census means you have to cover all the elements in the population. There is some kind of benchmark of the minimum sample size when you are doing some problem identification research. The minimum sample size itself to be near about 500. When you are doing some products test, nearly 200, 300 to 500, I had using some test marketing strategies, 300 to 500 or minimum sample, maybe 200. When you are testing some effectiveness of commercial in advertising or TV or internet, then 150 to 200 or something. When you are doing some stores, then at least you have to cover some 20 stores for the retail sector. When you are doing some focus group interviews or focus group research, then it's better to conduct in research within minimum of 2 focus groups. So this we have already covered. Probability sampling, these are the probability sampling and these are the non-probability sampling. Continuous, generator, quota and snowball. And probability sampling are simple random sampling, systematic sampling and stratified and cluster other examples. Now we move forward to the next part of data analysis. Now which test we should apply, we should conduct to our data depends on the two characteristics of data. When we see data, we can classify data into two basic things: metric data, or which is also called parametric data. Metric or parametric data means that the data is captured in an interval scale or in a scale of somehow you can say Likert scale, a rank scale, an ordinal scale. So when the data is captured in an interval of rank or ordinal scale, then that kind of data is called parametric or metric data. Suppose we are conducting a survey asking the requiring this customer perception towards retail marketing or towards retail malls or stores, then we made a questionnaire, and in that questionnaire we use Likert scale. So when we use Likert scale, it is a kind of interval scale. So that data, when we capture that data or key that data into this Excel format and then we export to the next PSS and then do some data analysis, then that type of data should be considered as a metric data. The opposite is non-metric, or you can say non-parametric. Non-parametric data is kind of data which is ordinal, nominal in nature. Suppose gender, we just nominate 0, 1, 1 and 2. Suppose education, PG, UG, school, we nominate this 1, 2, 3 or 3, 4, 5, A, B, C, anything. So these are the data in which we can only calculate the counts, the frequencies. So that type of data is called non-metric data, text data. Are generally also called non-metric data, quantitative data. So this is about data, type of data. In the choice of a test, there are one more characteristic of a sample. The sample can be independent or it can be paired. Independent means from this population, we take out 3 independent samples. Or from different populations, we make out 4 different samples. Okay, so suppose there are 4 in India, we take out 4 samples from 4 different states. So each sample is independent. Suppose from a single state, we take out 3 different samples from 3 different districts. These are independent. Paired means when the sample is drawn from the population and then some kind of test or experiment is conducted to this sample and then again it is tested and then some kind of test again applied and then again it is tested. So suppose this, what we have to check, pre-test and post-test characteristics. So when a sample is taken out only once but treated as a 2 sample based between the test or measure or experiment which is applied on it, then this becomes called a paired sample. Okay. So gender, the sample consists of a male constitute of a male and female is a kind of independent sample, but when a sample, when a female sample is treated with an experiment, then the pre-values and the post-values have to be compared, then it becomes a paired sample. So based on these two type of data characteristics and the sample, we can further classify the data analysis techniques. So the based on data, the data analysis technique can be categorized on two. Metric or parametric test. Non-metric. Or you can say non-parametric test. And based on sample, you can further classify this. This is one sample. This is two or more sample. This is one sample. Two or more sample. So this is based on the type of data. This is based on how the sample are drawn. Whether it is a one sample, whether the sample is drawn from two or more. Then from this two or more sample, whether that the two samples are independent, whether the two samples are paired or dependent. So when the two samples are independent, is called independent sample, and it is called paired sample. Similarly here, independent sample, and it is paired sample. So based on this, we can easily understood the test. So in a metric data, one sample, you can apply t test or z test. The two sample, independent sample, we can apply independent sample t test. In a paired, we can also apply independent paired sample t test. So t is a kind of, t and z are the parametric test. Here the one sample, it's a non-metric data. So we can only calculate the frequencies. So you can make only chi-square test. And similarly, you can also make here chi-square and chi-square here also. But apart from this, from independent sample, there are tests called Mann-Whitney test. And here, Wilcoxon test. Of paired sample here, and Mann-Whitney for independent sample, non-metric data. So based on this, we can check or select the test. So based on the sample and based on the type of the data you got from the data collection or from the research. Now when we test the data, first we have to make the hypothesis, and then how to test the hypothesis. What are hypotheses? Hypotheses are the unproven statements. What are the process of testing the hypothesis? First, you formulate the hypothesis. As you have already seen in the previous lecture, there are two kinds of hypothesis: null hypothesis or alternate hypothesis, H0 and H1. Null hypothesis means the no relation hypothesis, and alternate means then a hypothesis of having a relation. So null hypothesis means And a hypothesis which assumes that there is no relation between A and B, and an alternate hypothesis which means that there is a relation between A and B. So when we formulate the data, if I formulate the hypothesis, we make this two kind of types of hypothesis. And then based on this, we choose the test and significance value. Test from the previous chart, whether we should apply go for a parametric test or non-parametric test, whether we draw from a one sample test or two sample test or two independent sample or two paired sample test. So then from there we can select the test and the significance level. Generally it is level is 95%, significance level is 95%, and through this significance level we test whether this should be rejected or accepted. So this is how you can test this hypothesis. The remaining part, which we include why we choose this level of significance, what are the different levels of significance, how we can capture the data, how we can purify the data, how we can prepare the data for analysis, and how you formulate those results or present those results in the report format will be covered in the next lecture.